Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. James. We had last night just an amazing fundraiser for our music program. And so the choir has the day off. So we have a couple choir members in the congregation today, but most people are recovering. And Dan and I were saying neither one of us slept really well last night because, you know, your body's tired, but your head's just spins, and it was that kind of a night last night. So we are going to have congregational singing today, and we will not have some other congregational singing that we normally have. So your bulletin lets you know, your leaflet lets you know all of that today. So there'll be a lot more spoken word today, like the psalm and that type of thing. So just be prepared to participate in a different way today. Thank you for being here, and for those of you who were here last night, we really appreciated your attendance and participation. And for those who are still cleaning up after last night, thank you as well. I invite you to open your hymnals to number 182, and that is our opening hymn today. You can stand, and if you don't feel like you want to sing, sing anyway, or at least read it along with the words. We're doing verses 1, 4, and 5. Blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread. open the eyes of our faith, that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated, Lord, please.
First lesson, a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today we're going to read Psalm 4. Please recite in unison the psalm. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I am hard pressed. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you worship dumb idols and run after false gods? Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. When I call upon the Lord, he will hear me. Tremble then, and do not sin. Speak your heart in silence upon your bed. Offer the appointed sacrifices, and put your trust in the Lord. Many are saying, oh, that we might see better times. Lift up the light of your countenance upon us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine and oil increase. I lie down in peace, at once I fall asleep, for only you, Lord, make me dwell in safety. Now we have the second lesson, a reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see what I have. See that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I attended our annual HOA meeting on Thursday evening this past week. It was the first one I've attended here, and I wanted to meet some of our neighbors. I thought it might be a way to build community in this new place. We've only met a few neighbors. We've never socialized with any of them, and even though that's the case, we have entrusted some of them with the care of our cats when we've been away. I must report, an HOA meeting is not the best place to meet neighbors. It is also not the place to build community. There were no refreshments to encourage mingling, no time set aside for small talk. Two things that are so important to the building of relationships: eating together so that you can learn about one another. Nope. It was a leap into an agenda that had anticipated a visit from our representative from the company who manages our HOA. She never showed up. Of course, that created anxiety among the board members. They had voted to hire this company earlier this year, increasing our HOA fees by $75 to cover those and other minor increased expenses. According to the board's report, the company's representation has been less than helpful, and the company is likely to be fired, which will cause an uncomfortable ripple effect in the neighborhood. You see, our HOA has, like all HOAs, rules. A lot of rules. And our neighborhood, like all neighborhoods, has people who have extremely high set expectations that every rule be followed in the way that they interpret them. And in the past year, some very difficult arguments, fights, over the interpretation of a single rule has caused some, in my opinion, over-the-top reactions. I mean, why complain to the HOA before having a conversation with someone? Why not sit down and discuss the rule and how each party interprets that rule? And then explain perhaps the life situation that is causing the infraction. Is there a compromise that could be reached? Can a mediator be called in to explain the unclear bylaw? And if the HOA is called upon to handle the infraction, how much time should be allowed for the situation to be resolved? And if the HOA does not move quickly enough or it appears at all, should the offended call the police on the offender or recontact the HOA for an update? Suffice to say, voices were raised, people interrupted one another, and nothing was accomplished except to divide a community over a misunderstood bylaw and all of the inconsistent reporting of other neighborhood infractions. I've been stuck on this for the past few days. The thing is, building community takes trust. It takes communication. It takes eating together. It takes waving and stopping and offering to help someone struggling to get a large box into their house. It takes feeling comfortable enough to go next door for a cup of sugar or to borrow a ladder. But we have generally become a world of people who do not find trusting others to be easy. We can get defensive when we feel slighted. We fear repercussions. We hear of lawlessness and mayhem and seem to live our lives with one eye open, watching for whatever we need to watch for to protect our individual self or our family or our belongings. It can be easy to fall into this trap of distrust, of fear. We hear about it when we listen to the story of the Passion. And we heard it today from Acts when Peter spoke to the Israelites about the glorification of Jesus and then the quick 180-degree turn, rejecting him when the crowd got louder and called for the release of Barabbas. It can be easy to fall into this trap. We hear in 1 John that since we are all beloved, we are to live lives that are pure, that we should not sin, because if you sin, you are guilty of lawlessness. It can be easy to fall into this trap. We hear about it in today's gospel when the followers of Jesus are startled, terrified, disbelieving, and wondering if this is truly Jesus or a ghost or an imposter standing before them. In these examples, we hear not only about the sin, we hear about the power of repentance and of redemption. Even though we are to strive to be pure, to not sin, to not live solitary lives outside of community, we fail. And we fail daily. Even I got caught up in the heightened emotions at the HOA meeting requesting, or maybe firmly requesting, the bylaw in question be read not once, but twice, because in my and others' opinions, it is not clearly written. Because of this bylaw and the way certain neighbors have reacted, our immediate neighbors, who are the ones being accused, have bought property to build a house, and they plan to move within the year. And I'm both sad and angry. Sad because they've been kind to us. They loaned us their ladder. We chat. Angry because if this was a true community, a friendly neighborhood, people would be able to have kind and helpful conversations to solve problems, to help one another, and to live just a little closer to the beloved community that I believe God calls us to live. My neighbors have done their due diligence to get clarity on this bylaw, but others did not want to give them a chance to tell their story. They've contacted a lawyer who agrees the bylaw is not written well. They admit that if their interpretation, if he had said their interpretation of the bylaw was inaccurate, they would act accordingly. They're willing to leave what is becoming an untenable situation because some other people in the neighborhood have made them feel unwelcome in a place that has been their home for 4 years. She said to me and to a couple of others after the meeting, "Where's the neighborhood spirit?" Kind of wondering that myself. But I know that the loud voice of a minority of a population can change the personalities and attitudes of the majority. I also know that when we build bridges across our differing opinions and get to know one another, communities can be strengthened and they can thrive. The followers of Jesus became our models of this. They went from loving Jesus to shouting, "Crucify him!" in an angry mob. And Jesus came back to them, loving them, forgiving them, and like we heard in today's gospel, eating with them. These 50 days of Easter provide us stories of fear and distrust, of conflict and disbelief, of joy and wonder, of showing us how to overcome all these things, all these negative things, through repenting, forgiving, and accepting one another with the same love Jesus has for each of us. When Jesus says, "Peace be with you," he's telling us it is possible to repent and to forgive. I'm hoping that I can go back to feeling blissfully ignorant and comfortable in my neighborhood, knowing that ultimately people are good. But for a little while, it will probably sting to think that some people do not have the tools for healing and would rather stand so firm in their convictions that they inflict pain on others without really understanding the unique lives and deep belovedness of all their neighbors. Because ultimately, life is all about love. And we sometimes forget. Even the disciples did not believe it was Jesus standing before them without seeing his hands and his feet, without eating fish with them, and being reminded that we are to love one another. And if they need to relearn, sometimes so do we. When we get to the questions in our baptismal covenant in just a minute, I'm going to pause after you respond, "I will with God's help." In that pause, I invite you to consider what the question means to you in your life experience. And now let us pray. We believe in you, Creator, because through your Son, you have taught us what it means to love you by loving one another. Loving can be hard. We see examples of how hard it can be in many places in our lives. Give each of us courage to be examples of love in all our communities. Help us be people who listen, learn, and grow with others, accepting the unique ways in which you have created them. Help us know when rules or laws break the bonds of community rather than lift us into deeper awareness of one another. For Jesus taught us the importance of living together, of learning together, and of relying on one another to your glory. Amen. Together, let us renew our baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
Amen.
Christ, the Son of God.
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered from the cross of God, was crucified by God, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? In the breaking of bread and in the prayers. Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will without self.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being? May Almighty God, who has given us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, bestow upon us the forgiveness of sins and call us to ministry in Jesus Christ. Keep us in eternal life by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Prayers of the People, April 14th, 2024, Third Sunday of Easter. In this season of Easter, let us offer our prayers with all our heart, mind, and body, saying, Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. Gracious God, inspire all church members and leaders, lay and ordained, to know your saving power and serve you with true humility. We pray for the church throughout the world. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Terry, our bishop, Debbie, and Mary, our clergy. We pray for the Anglican Church of New Zealand and Polynesia, for St. Mark's Church Louisville, for all people, paid or volunteers who help to maintain the cleanliness, safety, and aesthetics of our historic church. Lord, in your mercy. Give discerning hearts and minds to those who hold authority in the nations of the world, that they may move toward peace and reconciliation and away from violence. We pray for all countries torn apart by violence and war, for those who have died in all places of strife, for civilians, for members of the military, and for their families. Comfort them in their loss. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayers. Show us, your human family, how to share and mobilize resources so that those in need and those with plenty may join together. Deepen our desire, sharpen our will and intention to respect the dignity of all. We pray for all of those in our own city, country, and around the world who suffer from homelessness or poverty or who cannot find work. Lord, in your mercy, inspire all in this community to learn and grow in our knowledge and love of you. Bless our relationships with one another that we may speak and act in love, truth, and humility. Be in our praying, thinking, and all that we do. We pray especially for Adrian, Barbara and Ed, Bob, Charlie, Dolores, Dorothy, Greg, Harold, Joe, Jim, Jimmy, John, Liz, Mary, Michael, Ryan, Sue, and Tom. For presiding Bishop Michael Curry and Bishop Terry White, for those who have received our healing blankets, and for all those we now remember either silently or aloud. We seek to expand our reach that we may choose your will. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of resurrection and all the blessings of this life. We give thanks for all we name now, silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, give rest, O Christ, to those who have died where sorrow and pain are no more, either sighing, but life everlasting. We pray for those we name now, either silently or aloud.
Lord, in your mercy.
Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer.
Almighty God, you raised up Jesus Christ that the whole world may shine forth your presence. Open the eyes of our faith, and so infuse us with the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may bear witness to his name in all the cares and occupations of our lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Tomorrow night, the vestry is meeting at 6:30. We ask that you pray for us while we meet. And next Sunday is our Red Cross food collection. We're going to move that to the third Sunday. So because the first Sunday was Easter, so we wanted to make sure that we have a good collection. We're going to start doing this on the third Sunday anyway. Be sure to take a bag at the back of the church, bring it back full of food, or just stick a check in it to Red Cross, Oldham County Red Cross, and they will use those funds to be able to purchase more than we can with those dollars. Do you want to say anything about last night?
Thank you to all who made last night possible. It definitely took a village. We nearly doubled our goal. So maybe I'm more happy about that. Sorry, I'm a little bit tired today. but I wanted to thank everyone who helped and attended. It was a fun evening, I think. And we had a great time. Thank you so much.
We have our general convention of the Episcopal Church coming up here at the end of June. And this is where leaders from around the world gather. And it's happening here in Louisville, which is kind of an exciting thing. Because it's happening here, we are invited to volunteer for a variety of things that are happening. A lot of the slots have been filled, but there is still room for more people to volunteer. The information to be able to do that is in your leaflet. Please do take it home and see if there's some time that you can give to the convention. Also, we open our convention with a revival with Presiding Bishop Michael Curry. This year, when we have this convention, we will be electing someone to replace Presiding Bishop Michael Curry with a new candidate. It's a 9-year role, and and so his 9 years are completed. And he will be done on All Saints Day in the fall. But we have 4 presiding bishop candidates, and I've listed those in here, and there's also a link so that you can go and learn about each one of these men. There are no women on the slate. And part of that reason is that there are things that you have to have before you can do that. You have to have been a priest, you have been a bishop for a certain amount of time. And there's just some things that many of the women who are bishops have not accomplished at this point in their careers. Also, some who have chose not to put their name in. So don't take offense at the fact that there are no women on the slate. There are really good reasons that are sound for why there are no women on the list. There are 4 men, and they are all quite good candidates. No one will be able to replace Presiding Bishop Randall Curry. He has a very unique way of telling us that it's not about love, it's not about God, and preaching that. So take a look to see, and we don't have a vote, so the bishops are going to vote amongst themselves for this replacement. But it's helpful for you to know who these people are. So you take a peek at that and take note of who they are. We still need some people to sign up for altar flowers and coffee hours, so please don't hesitate to meet in and volunteer for those things as well. Our offertory sentence today comes from 1 Chronicles. Yours, O Lord, is the brightness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom, and you are exalted as head over all. Thank you. things come from you, O Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, for he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who ever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, for the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we say together, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with James and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Hallelujah.
gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. This table is a table for all. If you feel called to receive today, you may come and meet me at the bottom of the chancel steps. Place your hands flat on each other so I can put the bread on the plate. Right here, on your plate with your hand. And go by your side to receive the wine. You don't have to receive the wine. It is not a requirement to be fully communed. If you choose to not receive today, you may come forward and cross your arms across your chest and I will give you a blessing. This is for all, so please do not feel like you are unwelcome. You are very, very, very welcome.
eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. Life is short, and we haven't much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel with us along the way. So be quick to love, make haste to be kind, and may the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Advocate, go with you today, tomorrow, and always. Amen. Please join us on hymn number 193. We're singing verses 1, 2, and 5.